John chapter 6, for the reading of the word of the Lord this morning. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to take a look at how. Somebody say how. How. How is not just a Sioux Indian word for hello. But how, I've always asked myself the question how whenever I hear a preacher preaching. Over the last 30 some odd years, I appreciate somebody telling me what I need to do, but all the more I appreciate somebody telling me how to do it. Amen. Amen. You know, we've heard sermons on the fact that we need to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. You know, we've heard sermons on, you know, husbands, love your wives. But rather than telling me I need to love my wife, rather than telling me that I need to love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, teach me how. Show me how to do it. And if you show me how to do it, I'll appreciate you all the more. Amen? And so for the next couple of weeks, we want to talk about a couple of things that we want to learn how to. How to walk in the peace of God. How many of you know we need to learn how to walk in God's peace? How to walk in the Spirit. How to face your fears and overcome your fears. And so this morning we're going to talk about how to find peace in your storm. How many of you know that we will have storms in life? And this morning, I know that there are some of you that are in storms. There are only three types of people. There are those that are just coming out of a storm, those that are right now going through a storm, and those that are heading into a storm. And so this morning, if you're enjoying peace and you're on the shore of your life and you don't have any problems, my congratulations to you. Turn to your neighbor, tell them congratulations. But listen to me. If that's you this morning, I have some news for you. It won't be long. And I'm not prophesying negativity over you. I'm not prophesying gloom and doom over you. I'm just saying that life happens. And sometimes you get a phone call or you go to the doctor or you wake up one day and your whole life is changed. How many of you know that that can happen? Yeah. You could be walking along and in your early 40s and all of a sudden, ladies, you can be pregnant again. And I'm prophesying over somebody this morning. No, I'm just teasing. But, you know, you can already be past all that stuff and raised your children and then all of a sudden wake up and you're starting all over. That can happen. Turn to your neighbor, tell them, hopefully not to me. But that kind of, and your whole life has changed. Are you following what I'm saying this morning? And so this morning we're going to take a look at John chapter 6. If you're there, say I'm there. If you're ready, say let's go. And we're gonna look at the disciples, and this is a very, very familiar portion of Scripture. The disciples and Jesus, they have just come through one of the most miraculous, powerful, amazing miracles in all of the Word of God. You know the story. Jesus has been teaching all day. The people get hungry, and the disciples come to him and say, Lord, the people are hungry. Send them away that they might find something to eat. Jesus looks at the disciples and he says, you give them something to eat. Well, you know the story. They bring Jesus a couple of loaves and a couple of fish, and he prays, breaks them, they pass them out, and 5,000 men besides women and children are fed. Now, this is just right after that great miracle. Jesus commands them in Matthew chapter 14 to get into the boat and go to the other side. Now, may I say to you, when Jesus tells you to go to the other side and to go over, if he commands you to go over, you're not going to go under. Are you with me? And so the Bible says they get in this boat, this ship, and they begin to go to the other side. As they go to the other side, you know the story. This great storm arises. And we're going to look at John chapter 6, beginning in verse 16, as we read our text this morning. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into the boat and set off across the lake. Now, like I said, in Matthew 14, he commands them to get into the boat. Now, it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them, and a strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. And when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were afraid. They were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I." Somebody say, "It is I." If you got your Bible, circle that word "I." It's important for our purposes this morning. "It is I. Don't be afraid." Then they were willing to take him into the boat. See, then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. This morning I want to speak to you upon the subject, how to find peace in the midst of your storm. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. It's a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. And Lord, there are those this morning that are sitting on the shore and the day is beautiful. There's only a gentle breeze and they're watching a sunset and life has been good. They are full, just like the disciples were full. The disciples, as they watched that miracle, must have been full of joy, full of encouragement, full of hope, full of faith, full of self-confidence. And yet, you made them get into a boat. And Father, we love the shore. We love to sit on the shore. We love to enjoy the good times of life. But Father, sometimes we find ourselves in the boat, and there are some people today that are in the boat. There are problems in these pews. Father God, there is problems represented here today. And I just pray that if there are those here that are trying to find peace, looking for peace, wondering where can I find peace today, may they find the principles that bring peace in their lives. Speak to our hearts, we pray, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. 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 Now, again, like I said, this was a beautiful day. The disciples had just enjoyed a miracle. I suppose there probably was hardly even a breeze because sometimes before a storm, there's that calm. There's that hush that comes in, and I'm sure the disciples must have been excited as they were looking at one another, coming out of that miracle, thinking to themselves, man, this is awesome walking with Jesus. And yet Jesus makes them get into a boat. As they get into that boat, begin to row to the other side, up comes this huge wind. And the Bible says they toiled all night. Now, really, in reality, it might have seemed like it was all night, but it was about 4 hours that they had been rowing. Now, that's easy for me to say, right? I don't know how many of you have been out on a boat lately and how many of you have tried to row against the wind, but they were rowing against the wind for 4 hours. And as they were rowing, you know the story, Jesus comes walking on the water. They thought it was a ghost. And yet, the Bible says they were willing to welcome him into their boat, and when they did, immediately, I want you to see this, immediately, they were from where they were to where they needed to be. Listen, Jesus can take you immediately from where you are to where you need to be in just a moment. Amen? Now, my question to you this morning is, are you in a storm? If you're not, enjoy the trip. If you are, I've got some lessons for you to learn. And like I said earlier, I've learned as a pastor that although there are, you know, all kinds of smiling faces in the pews, there are some hardship in the pews. There are problems in these pews this morning. And if this message isn't for you, maybe it will be. But perhaps this message is for you today. And there are three principles I want us to see in this scripture that are going to help you. Some say three principles for peace. Three principles that are going to help you make it through your storm in life. Number one, when you go through the storm, write this down. You need to know that what you're going through is in God's plan. It's part of God's plan. God is a sovereign God, and he governs everything. And we are not walking in happenstance or circumstance, but we are walking in divine providence as children of God. Amen? And so whatever you're going through, God is in control. Some say God is in control. The second thing you need to understand is not only is God in control and God have a plan, but secondly, whatever you're going through is in God's purpose. Some say God's purpose. Some say God's plan, God's purpose, And then finally, we're going to see God's power. Some say God's power. How many of you want the power of God in your life? You see, if you want the power of God in your life, you need to go through some stuff. And as you go through some stuff, his power will be revealed in your life. See, we want the power of God, but we don't want to pay the price to find the power. And so this morning, as we look at this, there are some things we need to learn concerning that journey. And number one, the fact is that we are in God's plan. Some say, I'm in God's plan. Do you believe that? You believe you're a child of God, in the plan of God, walking in the purpose of God? You see, sometimes we take a look at the circumstance we're in and the storm we're in, and we say to ourselves, I must be out of God's will. But I need to remind you this morning that storms are in the middle of the will of God. The disciples went into the children of Israel went into the promised land, and there were giants in the promised land. And they could have taken a look around and said, you know what, we don't belong here. There are swollen rivers, there are walled cities, there are giants in the land. And in fact, half of them, most of them did. Most of them said, there's no way. These giants, we can't go into the promised land. And yet, two of the 12 spies looked and said what? They said, these giants, they'd be bread for us. Can I say to you this morning that problems are the breakfast of spiritual champions? And this morning, if you find yourself in a problem, if you find yourself in a storm, I've got good news for you. You're probably smack dab in the middle of God's will. And what God wants to do is God wants you to grow. Amen? We're going to see that here in just a moment. Now, first thing we need to see is we're in God's plan. We're governed by God's providence. See, what happened to these people that day was not happenstance. It was not a mistake. It was not something that should have been avoided. This storm did not take Jesus by surprise. This was not incidental, but it was providential. It was not accidental, but it was providential. Matthew 14, 22, immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat. What was he saying? He's saying, hey, you guys get into the boat. And they must have looked at him and said, why? We're good here. And he said, no, get into the boat. And so he made them get into the boat. Now, why did God make them get in? Why has God sometimes engineered problems in our lives? Hello? I know some of you are thinking, man, that's just the devil. That's the devil that's making me. Well, it might be. Or you know, maybe it's your own fault, but you know, whether it's the devil or your God is over all of this. And God, even if it's the devil, has allowed you to be where you are. And so we need to ask ourselves, God, why have you engineered this? David said in Psalm 107 that they saw the works of the Lord, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke and stirred up a tempest. Somebody say, he stirred it up. He stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves. What's he saying here? He's saying it's God who's the master of the wind. It's God who's the master of the waves. He's the one often that causes storms to come. Now, listen, we're going to have difficulties. And the first thing you need to learn is that when difficulties come, that God is over everything, that he's in control. See, I can handle that. If I know God's in control and I'm his and he's not going to allow me to go through anything that I can't bear, I can handle whatever it is I'm going through. And I can have peace in that. If a sickness comes, I can have peace in that. If a pregnancy comes, we can have peace in that. I'm not saying it's going, God forbid. But if it does, hallelujah. Just call me Abraham. No. Lord, I'll take that back. But you know what I'm talking about. Whatever it is we go through, if we go through a sickness, if we go through a death, if we go through a loss, if my business goes down, as long as I know that God has me in the palm of his hand, as long as I know that he's watching over me and that he watches the sparrows that light on the ground and he watches and takes care of the flowers that grow in the field, and if he takes care of the grass and the flowers and the sparrows and all of that stuff, he's going to take care of me, and I don't have to worry about that stuff because my God's in control. Turn to your neighbor, tell him your God's in control. So first of all, God's in control. Secondly, he has a purpose. Some say he has a purpose. I like what C.S. Lewis said when he said, hardships often prepare ordinary people for extraordinary destiny.
I love that. Hardships often prepare ordinary people. Any ordinary people in this place? Well, maybe what you're going through is God allowing you to go through a hardship because he wants to prepare you, an ordinary person, for an extraordinary destiny. Well, I love that. See, we need to know, the second thing is that whatever we're going through is in God's purpose. God has a plan. Some say he has a plan. And he has a purpose. Now, what's the purpose? What's the purpose of God for your life? What's the purpose of God for your life? Just to bless you? To show forth his goodness? That's part of it. But can I submit something to you this morning? God's purpose for your life isn't just to indulge you. I know there are many people who would say, you know, God just wants to bless you. He wants to, you know, name it, claim it, do it. And you know, there's part of that's true. But God's purpose for you isn't just to indulge you. As grandparents, we know what that's all about. We indulge our grandchildren. That's our job. Our job is to spoil them. When we went to Des Moines 2 days ago to see Jacob and his children, we stopped at the store on the way over and bought cookies and cake and all kinds of sweet stuff. And when the children came home, it was party time. Why? Because as grandparents, it's our job to spoil and indulge them and let the parents take care of the rest. Right? That's what we do. We buy them toys. We buy them candy. We party whenever we see them. That's our job. Listen, that's not God. God's not here to indulge you. He's here to enlarge you. And if they keep eating that candy and cake and stuff, they will be enlarged. But God doesn't just want to indulge us. He wants to enlarge us. He wants us to grow. And oftentimes he uses pain. Let me ask you a question. For those of you that have been around for a little while, how many have been serving Jesus for at least 5 years? Let me see your hands. Okay, many. How many of you for 10 years? How many of you for 20 years? Anybody been serving Jesus over 40 years? Let me see your hand. Okay, wow, quite a few of you. All right. So look, those of you that have been serving God, those of you been around for a little while, let me ask you a question. Looking back over your life, when are the times that you grew most? Times in which there were no problems? Times in which everything was good? Or times in which you didn't know whether you're going to make it till tomorrow? Times in which you didn't know whether or not you were going to keep your mind. Times in which you didn't know whether or not you could even breathe because you had been hurt so much and the wind had been taken out of your sails and you just didn't know what to say or where to go. And the only place you could go was to your knees and put your eyes upon God because men could not give you the answer that you were needing and the peace and the joy and the grace that you were needing. And it drove you into the presence of God. That's where you and I grow. It's when we go through those hard times. Now, I don't want to go through those times all the time, but God knows we need them. He knows we need to go through some stuff in order to get where he wants us to go. And the disciples wanted, Jesus wanted the disciples to grow. See, there are two kinds of storms. There are correcting storms and there are perfecting storms. Jonah had a correcting storm. Jonah was going the wrong way, and God sent a storm. Jonah turned around. And sometimes God sends correcting storms. But most of the times, storms for the child of God are not correcting storms. They are perfecting storms. They are storms that cause us to go deeper. You know, they talk about the palm tree. I don't know if you've been watching the news, but in the Philippines, there are winds of 190 miles an hour. I can't imagine that. And they're showing this wind blowing, and these trees are just. And the wind has just blown them over, and they're
bending. And you know what, when that wind stops? That didn't happen overnight. It happened little by little. As the breeze came, the roots went down. As the larger breeze came, the roots went down a little further. As the storm came, the roots went down a little further. Now there will be some of those trees that they bend, and the roots will come out because they're not down far enough. But those trees that have taken their roots and dug deep down, and there are some of you that have dug deep down into the Word of God. You've dug deep down into the presence of God. You've dug deep down into the personality of God. And you know that no matter what storm comes, my God is in control, and God is trying to teach me something. And over the years, you've got your roots down, and that storm has come. And you might be like this today, but the storm's going to pass. And tomorrow you're going to straighten back up and lift your eyes and lift your hands and say, oh, though the Lord slay me, yet will I trust him. Hallelujah. I know that God be for me. And if God be for me, who can be against me? Oh, hallelujah. My God is in control. I might be hurting today, but God's in control. I'm going to dig a little deeper down in him. You see, you need to realize God has a plan. That God's in control. These disciples weren't out of the will of God. They were in the will of God. Now, why would Jesus want them to go through a storm? Because he wants them to grow. I read a little poem I want to share with you. It said, I walked a mile with pleasure. She chatted all the way, but left me none the wiser for all she had to say. I walked a mile with sorrow. Not a word, said she. But oh, the things I learned from sorrow when sorrow walked with me. Isn't that true? We walk a mile with pleasure, and she's chatting all the way, but she leaves us none the wiser. But when you walk with sorrow, oh, the things you'll learn when sorrow walks with you. Somebody said that faith is like a film, it's developed in the dark. You want faith, it's developed in the dark. And remember, don't doubt in the dark what you know to be true in the light. Amen? Amen. Jesus came. He said, it is I. Be not afraid. Listen, it's God. Whatever you're going through, God's in control. Some say it's God. I can see these disciples rowing, perspiration on their brow. Their faces are a network of fear. Their clammy hands are holding on to the oars. Peter says, pull harder. Got to get to the other side, boys. We're going to sink. Come on, row. And Thomas is saying, we're going to die. No, we're going to do the other side. I doubt it. If you read the story, they've been out there for 4 hours. Their arms about ready to fall off. Their backs are breaking. For 4 long, agonizing hours, they've been out there. And here's what I think. I think if I'm out there, Jesus has told me to get in the boat. My question is, where's Jesus? No, Jesus isn't in the boat. Jesus, he's going to come to them in just a moment, walking on the water. But look, he told us to get in the boat. Where's you? He's forgotten. Yeah, you ever feel that God is somewhere off in the distance and he's forgotten you? Have you ever asked yourself the question? Here's the question. Where's God in all of this? I sat up with a family up in the hospital just yesterday. And I prayed for their little baby. She was born and she's having complications. And you look at that perfect little baby. And sometimes you say in a sickness like that, you ask yourself, God, this isn't fair. Where's God in all of this? If you haven't been there, you will be. And the disciples were there. They were asking God, where are you? Where are you in my pain? Where are you in my sickness? Where are you in my loss? Where are you? God, what's the purpose? Jesus has forgotten me. Jesus has forsaken me. Listen, if I read the story right, Jesus had just fed 5,000 people.
Men. And when it was done, he said, I want you here, take these picnic baskets, pick everything up. See, Jesus doesn't waste anything. He doesn't waste your sorrow. He doesn't waste your pain. He doesn't waste your tears. He didn't waste that bread. He's not going to waste your pain. And so they pick up the, and why was it 12 basketfuls? Can I tell you? There was one for each disciple. They took their little doggy bag and got in the boat. They had fish and chips on the way home. And I can just imagine them sitting down and they've got their little bag sitting at their feet and they're rowing and they're saying to themselves, Jesus has forgotten us. But if they would just look down, they would see that picnic basket there. They'd see the fact that Jesus had provided over there. And if he provided over there, he's going to provide again. And the fact wasn't that Jesus had forgotten them. The fact was they had forgotten him. They had forgotten what he just did. They had forgotten the miracle they just walked through. They had forgotten the power that they had just witnessed. And it was only a couple of hours, and they had already forgotten. And maybe what we do is in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of our black and darkness, we forget what he's done for us in the past. I don't know if he's done anything for you lately, but he delivered me from some stuff. He's healed me from some stuff. He has brought me out of some stuff. And sometimes I just need to look back and remember what he did for me so that I can go ahead and go forward. And the problem isn't that God has forgotten us. The problem is that we've forgotten God. Amen. We forgot his love. We forgot his mercy. We forgot his deliverance. We forgot his power. We forgot his grace. We forgot how God came through then and how he's going to come through again. Hallelujah. Let's not forget God.
See, Jesus had done all those miracles. Now, they thought that he forgot. And how many times did Jesus deliver us? Now, the Bible says he waited. Some say he waited. He waited. He waited. He waited. He was on the mountain praying, and he was waiting, watching. My question is, why is God waiting? God, why don't you just heal me now? Why don't you just come through now? Why don't you just give me peace now? Why don't you just resurrect my business now? Why don't you just now? Isaiah tells us why. Isaiah 30 verse 18 says, and therefore will the Lord wait. How many of you know God's not in a hurry? Come on, you people. He's not in a hurry. Isaiah says, therefore will the Lord wait. Why? So that he might take you through the ringer? Come on, church, are you with me? Therefore will the Lord wait. Why? So that he might be cruel to you? No, therefore will the Lord wait that he might be gracious. Have you ever been through a divine delay? Has God ever taken his good old time in your situation? And you're going, come on, God, change him now. Change her now. I have found, in my short experience with God, over the last 30, I have found God's never in a rush. And sometimes he even delays. But I have found that his delays are not his denials. And sometimes he delays, why? So that he might be gracious, according to Isaiah. He might be gracious unto us. Have you read, you ever read John chapter 11? John chapter 11, they come to Jesus and they say, Mary and Martha has called you. And he's only like four miles away. And they say, Lazarus is sick. But Jesus hangs out for 2 days before he goes to see Lazarus. And even then, by the time he gets to Lazarus, it's been 4 days. And my question is, has God ever taken his time in your life? See, by the time he gets there, here's what he says. Lazarus is dead. Read this for yourself. I know some of you are gonna look at me and you're gonna say, that's not in the Bible. Yeah, it is. Jesus gets there. Martha's mad at him because he should have come 4 days earlier. Mary is freaked out.
Her brother is dead. She's crying her eyeballs out. Jesus shows up with the disciples, and here's what he says. Lazarus is dead. No, this is even before he went. Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad. Hello, what? Read the rest. He says, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes. I'm glad for your sakes. Why? Because Jesus could have went and he could have healed Lazarus. But Jesus wanted to teach the disciples something. What did he want to teach them? He wanted to teach them his character. He wanted to teach them who he was. You see, when you go through something, God has a purpose. What's the purpose? So that you will grow. And sometimes God waits a little while so that he might be gracious unto you. And Jesus waited so that Lazarus would die, because the disciples had already seen him heal the sick, but they hadn't seen him raise the dead. And now he was going to take them to another level. And he waited. He said, and I'm glad Lazarus is dead, because if Lazarus didn't die, I wouldn't have an illustration and you wouldn't be able to learn. So Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad. Why? Because you're going to learn now. I'm not just a healer, but I'm the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. I have the power even to raise people from the... See, we wouldn't have the story, Lazarus, come forth, if he would have went and healed Lazarus. No, but we love to preach. Lazarus came forth with those old grave clothes, and they took him off. And Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were to die, yet shall he live. Hallelujah. See, we would know that God is the powerful, wonderful, awesome, wonder-working God that he is, had he not allowed Lazarus to die. Oh, I'm glad he did, so I could know him for who he is. Oh, my. I'm preaching better than your amen in this morning. But that's all right. Now, you see, Lazarus, Jesus said, I have a plan. Martha didn't see his plan. Mary didn't know his plan. But Jesus had a plan. He said, I'm going to wait so that I might be gracious to you. How many times have we tried to pick God's blessings before they were ripe? We want God to do it now. God says, no, leave it on the vine a little bit. No, God, I want it now. No, leave it alone a little bit. I'm going to take it now. It's not ripe yet. It's not ready yet. And we go and we pick God's blessings. And we get a partial blessing because we picked it too early. We wanted it too soon. And God says, no, wait. And if you wait until my blessing is ripe, you're going to see and enjoy the power like you've never seen it before. Oh, finally, what you're going through is going to reveal his power. You see, you can have peace when you know you're in God's plan. Some say, I'm in God's plan. I'm in God's purpose, and I'm going to see God's power. Come on, say it like you mean it. I'm in God's plan. I'm in God's purpose. I'm going to see God's power. I like this here. I like this because Jesus comes to them, and what does Jesus say? It is I. Be not afraid. Somebody said this, the will of God will not take you where the grace of God cannot keep you. That's worth writing down. I said, the will of God will never take you where the grace of God will not keep you. Whoever said that said a mouthful. The will of God will not take you where the grace of God cannot keep you. Disciples, get in the boat. Will of God will not take you where the grace of God will not keep you. They were out there rowing, and Jesus came walking to them, and here's what he said. It is I. Now, in the NIV, in the King James, in the English, it says, it is I. But if you look in the Greek, the best scholars say, he didn't say, it is I. He said, it is I am. That's a whole different ball game there. He says, I am. They said, that's a ghost. That's a phantom. It's an apparition. Row, get out of here. And somebody said, no, that's Jesus. Jesus, is that you? He said, it's I am. Oh, that's a mouthful there. He says, I am.
What does that mean? I am, I am, I am, I am, I am the Almighty. I am the everlasting. I am that I am. Before this storm was ever here, I am. Before Galilee was just, when it was just a vapor, I am. Hallelujah. You see, it's not just I was or I will be, but I am. Are you with me this morning? I am that I am. There never was a time when Jesus was not. There will never be a time when he will not be. And my question to you is, do you know what the I am is? It's an unfinished sentence. He says, I am. I am what? I don't know. You fill in the blank. I am. 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 He says, I am that I am. Read the Gospel of John. All through the Gospel of John, he says, I am. I am. I am. I am what? I am everything you need in the time you need it for the very purpose you need it for. I am. I am what? If you're lost, he says, I'm the way. If you're on the wrong side and want to get out, he says, I'm the door. If you're hungry, he says, I'm the bread of life. If you're stumbling in darkness, he says, I'm the light of the world. If you're in dead in trespasses and in sin, he says, I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were to die, yet shall he live. He says, I am. I am. I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. I am. And I'm going to tell you, my friend, he is what you need him for today. He is. I don't know what your problem is, but I know what your answer is. Hallelujah. Your answer is Jesus. Last thing this morning, I've got about 6 minutes left. Look at verse 21. The Bible says, and they willingly received him into the boat. He said, I am. And they said, you are. Come on in. And immediately, I love this. They willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they went. Listen, my friend, God hadn't promised you smooth sailing, but he's promised you a safe landing. They didn't have smooth sailing, but they had a safe landing. And can I propose to you this morning, your destiny is already determined. You might feel like you're going under. God says, you're not going under, you're going over. They said, man, the waves are over our head. God, I'm over my head. I'm over my head in this business. I'm over my head in this marriage. I'm over my head in finance. I'm over my head. I'm over my head. These waves are over my head. And God says, look, whatever's over your head is under my feet. He was walking on their problem. And here, Jesus steps into their boat. And as he steps into the boat, whew, they're there. Can you imagine? What must have been that? They must have... Teleportation. They're there. That will freak you out. You're in a storm. Jesus, get in my boat. They're there. Can you imagine the conversation after that? It's like, whoa. You see, time and space are no impediment to God. He's the Lord over all that. I am that I am. And may I say to you, if you invite Jesus in your boat, you're going to get to the other side. I think it was Andrew Murray who said this. He said, God is willing to assume the full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. I love that. You see, if you yield your life totally to him, he will assume full responsibility to get you to the other side. How do you do that? You say, Jesus, I willingly receive you into my boat. See, the way you get to the other side is by allowing Jesus to come into your boat. Can I tell you, the storm's on the horizon for America and for the world? We're entering into a time in history in which if we don't know him and our roots are not grounded in him, that wind and that wave might uproot some of us. And yet the only way to make it to the other side, I don't know about you, I believe in the rapture. I believe Jesus Christ is coming soon. And the only way to get to the other side is by allowing him to get into your boat. And one of these days, if you've allowed Jesus in your boat, next thing you know, you're going to be on the other shore. I believe it. And if Jesus isn't in your boat, God help you. You can keep rowing. And we'll probably be watching from the other side. But I don't know about you. I don't want to be rowing. I want to be on the other side. I want to say, Jesus, get in my boat. Yeah. And if he's in your boat, he'll immediately take you to the other side. Amen?
Yeah. Amen.